You know, for today, we're going to continue this sermon series that Pastor Dan had started last week. This is our part two of Abiding in the Vine, Virtues and Vices. You know, how many were blessed by Pastor Dan's message last Sunday? Yeah, honestly. And I think God is really moving through this series, and we're not done yet. We got our final. We're closing out the series next week, and be ready and be prepared for God to move and change your life, because he's changing my life even just through preparation through this. You know, for maybe some of us, we came out of service last week and we were like, oh, praise God, that was super encouraging and uplifting, and I'm ready to go out and abide in Christ. And then on the other hand, maybe some of you, this concept of abiding was a little more difficult and a little hard to swallow. And it can be difficult at times, this walk in Christ that we have to bear as believers, but it's a responsibility that we carry. You know, nonetheless, I really think we all have room to grow. If you heard me preach before, you probably heard me say this, but I think it's because we have room to grow. My professor always said in college, one of the professors that I was really close to, Brother Pat, he's the man. If you don't know him, he's the man. But he always said the biggest room in the world is the room for improvement. And I love it because it's so true. There really is so much room for us to grow, right? We always have room to grow. So in the same way, we have to grow. It's a responsibility for us as disciples in Christ. So, you know, this vine and branches concept that we're kind of dealing with this whole sermon series, you know, it really paints a perfect picture for us in this, an ideal metaphor, you know, and it parallels to the life of Christ and how we are to live our lives. You know, as a branch grows through the connection of the vine, we are to grow in our connection with God. As a branch is really absolutely nothing apart from God, we, in the same way, cannot do nothing without him. And we become strong just like a branch becomes strengthened by God, by the vine. We become strengthened by God. So God has called his disciples to abide in the vine and bear fruit. And this is a little bit what we talked about last week. You know, if we look back on our first part in the sermon series, Pastor Dion focused on these things. And he pointed out from John chapter 15 verses 1 to 4, which I'm just going to read real quick as before we move forward. So he says, I am the true vine, and the Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me as I remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. So last week we discovered two points, and I think Pastor kept it real simple for us so we can take something to the bank home last week. So does anyone remember the first point we learned last week? Anybody can just shout them out. Oh, I'm telling. Well, the first point is bearing fruit is not an option. So now you can go home and write that down so you'll be prepared for when he comes back. But the goal for every believer in Jesus Christ is to produce fruit. Producing fruit is the outcome of being a disciple. It shows that you are connected to God. All right, does anyone remember the second point? Maybe you don't remember the first, but maybe you can remember the second point. There you go. Stay connected to the source. Jesus wants us to stay in relationship with him, connected straight to him, and always only him our source, not on our own strength, not on somebody else, but in connecting with him. So I pray that this concept of abiding in God challenged us to look at our lives last week and really reflect on what we're bearing. What are we currently bearing in our daily lives just today? You know, are we truly abiding in the vine? And there's a lot of context within that question. But if fruit is a result of discipleship, then shouldn't we be fruitful? Shouldn't our lives be automatically fruitful in God? You know, when others come into contact with us, and this could be a toe stepper here, but when they come into contact with us, naturally, these are the things they should see. They should not see the world. They should not see evil desires in our hearts. Even though we were born in flesh, God has called us to a spiritual life. You know, what tastes are we giving off? Pastor mentioned this last week. Is it a sweet, juicy, ripe fruit that people are grabbing off our tree, off our life, that's connected to God? Or is it just a dry, hollow, rotten, or even artificial wannabe life? You know, we sometimes can have a habit of going through the motions and just faking it. And, you know, I think there's this, you know, to really understand being a part of God and all that he has for us, we have to really evaluate our lives. So I have a question for you guys, and that's what I was reflecting on this message. I thought about this. Does anyone still have those, remember those like fake fruit like centerpieces that we would put as decor and stuff like that? Does anyone still do that? Like I remember as a kid, like, and I walking into my grandma, I mean, you go to my grandma's house now, you literally go back to the 70s. I don't think she's changed a single thing. But so if you want to have a reminisce on your childhood, I'll tell my grandma, you'll meet her over there. So, but it's seriously, she always had those like those fake fruit, and they always look so real. They like, I don't know who in the world decided this would be a good idea. Like, as fruit is for eating, it's not for decorations. So as a kid, you walk in, you're like, you just look in the basket, you're like, oh, you know, I can go for some grapes right now. Well, that pear looks good too. Oh, I can go for an apple. But the disappointment that would soon follow when you grab the fruit and realize, well, this is not real. What a deception. But you know, I think there's something good that comes from this, that the moment you grab it, you know it's fake. The moment you can feel, well, we know as people what real fruit is. We've tasted it, we felt it, we eat it all the time in our lives. So when we know something that's fake and we see it and we feel it in our lives, it's evident. I think this is such a good example of what we do in our lives, because I really truly believe we've developed this idea and perfected this system of faking it. As believers, it's so easy to just go through the motions and fake it. And you know, sadly, we deceive ourselves into thinking that we are connected to God, that we are truly connected to him, but our root isn't even close to his root, and that is his vine. It's a whole different root in itself, and it's a root really of selfishness. You know, because really from the outside, the fruit may look good, this fake artificial fruit. The color is just right, and somehow they paint them and make it look like the light actually reflects off of it. It's like what? But ultimately, at the source of it, as soon as you go ahead, and even in our lives, as soon as someone goes ahead and picks that fruit, they're going to realize that this is just an imitation of what a real fruit really is. And it's sad, but as believers, I pray that we would really take a look deep into our lives. And that's what really this message and this series is all about. You know, when we truly abide in God and abide in the vine, we really do put aside our selfish desires. And under God's authority, it will produce virtues in our life. So this actually leads me into the message this morning. We're going to be focusing on virtues today. Virtues, living a virtuous life. It's the life that God intended. Excuse me. So I believe, you know, he wants us to be abundant in virtue. As he called us, and you look through scripture, and it's all there. But what does that mean for us? What does that mean for us? And even at the source of it, what does a virtue mean? What is it to mean like a life of virtue? So in order to answer these questions properly, you know, we must first go to the root of it all. So I want to really define what a virtue is. What does a virtue mean to you? I mean, maybe we can shout out some virtues that we could practice in our lives. Anybody could just maybe a couple? Try to get you involved. I know Pastor Deion does this. Patience, was kindness, yes. Love, yeah. Morals, honestly, and that's exactly where we'll be today. And those are perfect examples of virtue in our lives that we should practice. So I want to take a look at the Greek meaning. The virtue that we'll be looking at comes from the Greek word arte, which means moral excellence or moral goodness, virtue. I like how the Webster Dictionary defines it. It says, conformity to a standard of right, which is ultimately morality, a particular moral excellence, a beneficial quality or power of a thing. So we will either conform to the standard of this world, or we will conform to the standard of the vine, to the standard of God, which he had put into our hearts and lives. Virtues, really at its source, is natural byproducts for living for God. The byproducts that he has given us to be godly, to live a life worthy to the Father. You know, it's through the workmanship of the Holy Spirit that we are able to move and do and live a life of virtue. You know, these kinds of virtues show themselves in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22. Paul says this, "But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things." So it's clear that these fruits must be evident in our lives if something is going to come out of it. If some good is going to come out of it as we flow over, even this song, you know, "Fill me up, God." We need to be filled up with these fruits so that we can flow over into other people's lives, so that these fruits will naturally be flowing into other people as they pick it from our lives. Last week, Pastor showed us an example of virtues through these Eagles players. I think it might have paid off, but I won't go there. just the fact they were doing these Bible studies. They were, you know, couples Bible studies. They were baptizing some players before. These are just things of practicing out the virtue that God has intended us to live. So as we abide in God's word, virtues will flow naturally. And that kind of leads us to the text this morning. And we'll be pulling from chapter 2 Peter chapter 1. So Peter talks to the church at large in this text. After giving a brief greeting in verses 1 to 2, it's here in these verses to follow that Peter is giving us the answer for a productive, godly life. So this leads us to our first point this morning, and that is virtues are a natural product of abiding in Christ. Virtues are a natural product of abiding in Christ. Let's take it to the text. So 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3. You can turn there if you have your devices or Bibles. If not, we have it on the screen, I do believe. "His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. And because of his glory and excellence, he has given us a great and precious promises. These are the promises that enable us to share in his divine nature and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires." So the source of virtue in our lives is ultimately everything we need. To pertaining to a godly life, it's everything we need. I like how the NLT states it in verse 3. It says, "We have received all this by coming to know him, the only one who called us to himself by means of his marvelous glory and excellence." I think the focus, pivotal point here is on salvation. God wants us to come to him first. We cannot abide in the vine if we first aren't saved. That's how we first get attached to God. There's no abiding without first submission and salvation. You know, it's through the power of Christ, our power source, that he bears witness to these fruits that he's given us. Paul understood this. He's speaking to the Colossae church in Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 to 10. He says, "So we have not stopped praying for you since we heard about you. We ask God to give you complete knowledge of his will and to give you spiritual wisdom and understanding. Then the way you live will always honor God and please the Lord, and your lives will produce every kind of good fruit. All the while you grow as you learn to know God better and better." So there's one thing we have to establish this morning, is that moral excellence does not come from self-effort. There's nothing we could do in our own strength that can produce these kinds of things in our lives. You know, when we look at this passage here in 2 Peter, it's very clear that the central focus is God. I mean, look at it. "By his power, he has given, through our knowledge of him, calling us by his own glory." God is the source. God will always be the source for change and growth in our lives. So I guess I got to ask a question too. How many of you are growing through connect groups? How many of you are enjoying connect groups right now? We just kind of getting started. We got 17 groups. There's so much to offer with 17 groups, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 groups. So I have the privilege to lead my group. And if any of you don't know, I actually lead a group. It's called Anatomy of a Disciple. I really truly believe, as believers in Christ, that we all need to hear these things. It's so powerful, and it will change your life. And you can actually view it in Right Now Media if you ever wanted to go look and take a look at it. But I'm reading the book right now, and we're going through it with my class, and we're really enjoying it and really kind of diving deep in it. But it's a powerful series, and I just want to pull a quote from the book that Dr. Rick Taylor writes. And he says this in association with change and authentic life change. He says, "In general, people do not believe human beings can truly change. Many confess in a defeated tone, 'I am who I am.' It has to come to a common thinking that most personal change you can hope for is some form of behavior modification. But all that has changed is your outward behavior, not the essence of who you are. Most Christians have applied the same unbiblical idea to Christianity and the church. You try to look different, try to act different. And this is so-called the growing Christian life. But deep inside, in the wellspring out of which real life comes, you are unchanged. Many believers have bought into this idea that this is all there is to becoming more like God. This is all there is to experience genuine life change. But sadly, they're mistaken. And it says here, biblically, that's not what God had in mind. He promised to make you a different person, not just make you appear as a different person on the outside. And I just think that's so powerful, because sometimes we do that as believers, and we try to focus in on what we can do in our lives and ourselves and I and me. And we ultimately fail because the source was never in God. The source was in our own strength. It was in our own power. You know, he promised to change us. He promised to make us different. And with that, there really is a promise when we abide in God. There will always be a promise when we abide in God. You take a look at Scripture. Promises are there. It would take you hours to count all the promises that God has spoken in his word. And even in verse 4, he talks about these precious promises. But even take a look. He promised to be with us in Isaiah 41:10, to never leave us or forsake us in Hebrews 13:5. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us, 1 John 1:9. He knows the plans he has for you, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, Jeremiah 29:11. These are just examples of some of the promises that God has made to his people, so long as we abide in him. You know, the promise that's focused here in this particular verse Peter's trying to convey is really ultimately I could consider it the ultimate promise. That's eternal life. You know, because he states here also previously in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 4, all praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by his great mercy that we have been born again. Because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, now we live with great expectation. May we always live with great expectation. Verse 4, and we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change or decay. Such a powerful promise. Such a powerful promise from God that really, if we cling to God, if we stay connected to him, we will inherit eternal life. But if we do not, he will cut us off and we'll be cut down from the source. I pray that would not be so for the church today. I pray that we would abide in God and understand that he is our source, that everything we really need is through his divine power, that we really can't rely on ourselves because ultimately we're going to fail every single time. His promises will make their way known in our lives, especially if we stay in his word, abiding in him. Because really, when you think about it, we don't have any resources whatsoever to be truly godly apart from Scripture, apart from what God has already provided for us and what he says in his word. God allows us to participate in his divine nature. It's never on us. It's an allowing on him. He allows us to have all that we have. And it's just amazing when you look at it. His virtues will naturally flow from us as we remain in him. It's just a given. As we remain, they will automatically come. As he's filling us up, like the song was we sing this morning, as he fills us up, they will naturally flow over because there's nowhere else for them to go. And it's so powerful. So what does that mean for us today as a church, as believers, disciples in Christ? Kind of leads us into the second point this morning. And actually, like last week, I also only have 2 points. So if you look at your watches already, we still got some time. But this means for us that a life of virtue requires progressive growth. That's our second point this morning. A life of virtue requires progressive growth. Because this is the thing I think that we miss sometimes as Christians in our walk with God. I mean, yes, he gives us everything we need in Scripture, you know, basic instructions before leaving earth. This is how we live our lives. But that still requires work on our part. It still requires us to put in so we can achieve something out of that. You know, our daily lives here on earth and this world will always be in competition with your spirit. It's a given. With a competition and a battle between your spirit and flesh. So that's why God is calling to us to live and fruitfulness, to put aside evil desires and put aside the corruption of this world. Peter says this two chapters later in chapter 3, in the current text we're in 2 Peter. He says this, "Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these things, be diligent to be found in him without spot or blemish and at peace." So prior to speaking these words of this inheritance that God is ultimately going to give us in the end, he's talking about these seven virtues in verses 5 to 9. And it's these virtues that originate from God. They're strictly pulled from the life of God, from the life of Christ. And it's evident if you look through scripture, you can see these things in the life of Christ as he walked on earth. Virtue flowed out of God naturally because he knew he was under authority from God in heaven. And the same applies for us. We got to know that we're under that authority before we can move, and those things will naturally come. You know, there really is a responsibility for us to grow in virtue. So let's take a look at 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 to 8. Peter says this, "For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, to mutual affection love." This is the key, verse 8. "For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." So it's here in verse 5 that we see this enjoining of an essential quality of exercising our faith, which is this virtue. Virtue is enjoining with this quality of exercising our faith. It goes hand in hand. They come and they mesh together. You know, the words "make every effort" in this specific passage, excuse me, it translates to applying, to bring to bear alongside. So there really is a responsibility for us. And honestly, for me, even me, I step up on here on this pulpit and I do not take that responsibility lightly. To be a leader in the church, I do not take that responsibility lightly. It takes work on my part to be invested and truly connected to God. And the same goes for us as people and believers in God. It takes work. You know, no one can go anywhere in life and think that it doesn't take practice to, you know, achieve certain things. You know, we got to practice virtue. And we practice these daily things in our life. That's when we begin to become better and better and better. You know, some of us might have thought this before. So, you know, you see someone who's really good at what they do and you're like, wow. Like, they're good. Like, man, this must have took some time. Like, they're really good. They're a master of their craft. You know, we say that they're a master of their craft. And yes, they are a master of their craft, but something that we don't know is the experience that they had to go through and the years that they had to put in to become there. You know, they don't just wake up one morning and they're a master at their trade. It's like, oh, I know how to weld that like a beast now. Like, this is great. You know, they have to put in the work. You know, you think about athletes, pro athletes, and all of us know, even some of us has played sports before in high school, in college. Even now the Olympics are going on. Does anyone watch the Olympics? I actually love watching it, but I just have no time. and with the time difference, I don't even know what time it starts. Is it in like Beijing or something? I don't even know. Anyways, but the Olympics are going on right now. You got to help me. Sometimes I spiral. But the Olympics are going on right now. And, you know, you look at all these gold medalists, even some people who achieve silver and they think that, you know, I didn't get gold. But everyone's striving for that gold medal. And the work that they got to put in, we can't fathom that work. You know, the time and times they have to fail to get to where they're going. But eventually they achieve that gold medal. And how fulfilling is that? You know, it takes hard work. It takes practice after practice. It takes endurance to become a pro at what we do. So if discipleship is a life that we claim as believers in Christ, why aren't we cultivating these fruits in our lives? Because in the same way, if a pro athlete practices certain things to make them better in their sport, we should be practicing these things in a godly manner as far as virtue goes, to become better at what we do as disciples. You know, an athlete knows he or she must put forth that effort, because if they don't, they will not reach their goals and where they're trying to reach and achieve. They have to study. They have to be diligent so that in the long haul, success in their career will take place. And I pray this over your lives today, that we would be successful Christians, not faking Christians and not going through the motion Christians, but we would really put in the work so that we would see God's fruits, not just investing in our lives, but flowing into other people's lives. And it spreads like wildfire. And I truly believe that to be true. It will spread like wildfire. So Peter's driving this home in verse 5 and 9. And I actually just want to read the Message Bible. Have you ever just took a look at the Message Bible? It kind of breaks things down a little bit, a little easier to understand. And I kind of just gives you a little different perspective. Just listen to this. It's actually really powerful. So the same text we were in, it says, "So don't lose a minute in building on what you've been given. Completing your basic faith with good character, spiritual understanding, alert discipline, passionate patience, reverent wonder, warm friendliness, generous love, each dimension fitting into and developing the others. With these qualities active and flowing, growing in your lives, no grass will grow under your feet, no day will pass without its reward as you mature in your experience of our Master Jesus." When people look at our lives, do they look and see, wow, he's truly a master of his craft under God's authority, obviously. He is our ultimate master. You know, if God's divine power has really given us everything we need for our godly life, we shouldn't waste a minute. We shouldn't waste a second, like, hopping on this train of just seeking after God and pursuing these qualities. They make us a better person, because naturally it's so easy as to fall back into what we know best, because that's what we were born in. And that's what Satan would love us to do. He wants us to fall back into these vices and these problems that we carry on a daily basis. But God has called us to a higher standard. You know, I truly believe that God gives us opportunity to practice our faith, to really live it out. Because when you think about it, listening really isn't enough. You know, you got to do it. You can read the word all day. You can read it and study it and be a pro at knowledge. And knowledge is great. And that's what he's even talking about in the scripture. We have to be in knowledge flowing in God. But there comes a point where we got to put it to action. There comes a point where we got to put it in motion. So God gives us these opportunities in our lives. So I just want to tell you a story this morning. For those of you who know me and know me well, you know this. I love the sport of hockey. I know I literally might be the only person in Hawaii that likes hockey. And that's all right. That's all right, you know. No one's really interested in the sport, but it's all right. I'll start my little club over here. It's going to happen. But no, I love the sport. And as a kid, I loved the sport. My cousin, his name's Brian, he played the sport for a living. He actually played in the NHL. And he's the reason why I love the sport so much. And I don't play as much anymore because, I mean, look where I'm at. But but I love the sport. I love watching it. And, you know, Washington Capitals, woo-hoo. Anyways, just had to throw that in there. But I want to tell you a little story. As a kid, I loved hockey. Like, I literally loved it. I literally spent time playing, like, all day. That would literally be my free time when I had the free time after school. I would just be playing over in my garage. And, you know, eventually, you know, it was just for fun. You know, I wasn't really great at it, but, like, I was kind of investing in, I was practicing. So eventually a time came where an opportunity faced itself to me, and I was like, oh, no way. A roller hockey league. Oh, a roller hockey league. Yes. Yes. I want to play in this roller hockey league. I've never roller skated at that time. So for me, this was a big step because, I mean, naturally you should know how to roller skate before you go into a roller skating hockey league. But me, no, I got them. We're going to keep moving. You know, I played a little bit of hockey. I know I got this. Anyways, we go to the place. It's called Skater's Choice. Could have been the wrong choice for me, but that's all right. We got there, and I got on a team. We were the Black Knights because we had black jerseys. Everyone had a color. You know how it was when you were young. You had a color, and then you had to add a name, Black Knights, Yellow Bees. Anyways, so I got on the team. The moment I got there, I was a little dumbfounded because I walk into the room, and, you know, there's It was like kids 3 years younger than me, like skating backwards, like doing all these tricks. I'm just like, whoa, I am out of my league here. There is nothing, like, I don't have these skills. I can't even hardly roller skate. But you know what? I bought all the materials I needed, and I went out there and I skated. Yes, I was not that great. But I was dedicated, and I loved the game so much that nothing was going to stop me from playing this game. Nothing was going to stop me. And even my dad was like, son, are you sure you want to do this? Like, and I know in his head he's like, you're going to embarrass yourself. I'm sure as parents I probably embarrassed them, but that's all right. I know they would say, no, we're so proud of you. But I know, you know parents, you know. No, it's all good. Love you, Mom and Dad. But eventually, I really did get better. But ultimately, I was just thinking about this moment in my life, and I look back and I think, you know, God used this as an opportunity for me. And eventually, so on the season, I scored one goal, but that was one good goal. I was pumped. And then the moment I scored it, I looked to the stands. The moment my Uncle Kevin's walking in and meeting everybody, no one even seen my goal. I was pretty salty, but that's all right. I was pretty salty. But eventually our team ended up going to championships, and we won championships. And then it was in that moment where I was looking at my trophy and I was like, I'm good. Later. Like, that's the last time I played as far as roller hockey goes. But I kept on playing for fun with my friends, and floor hockey was always a passion. So, but the point is, there was opportunity when this opportunity presented itself, I hopped on it. And even though I was way out of my league, nothing was going to stop me from pressing in and reaching this goal that I had to be a hockey player. Because ultimately, that's what it came down to. I wanted to play. I wanted to be a hockey player when I grow up. I mean, I'm nowhere near that, so. But it's all right. I love where I'm at, and God's doing so many great things. And sometimes God switches your passions. And that's just a natural thing. But I learned through this opportunity how to be patient. I learned how to be patient. I learned endurance. You know, plenty of my teammates were supportive, but there was always those people who were like, dude, he stinks. Like, why is he on this team? Like, bro, I can hear you, man, that hurts. God, I have feelings too. But luckily there's another kid that wasn't so good too, so we kind of balanced each other out. I might debate that I was a little better than him. Anyways, but God gave me these opportunities to endure, to have long suffering, to have self-control, because at times when I fell and I was skating and I kept on falling, I kept on failing, I missed the puck, I skate right past it when it's flying past me. These are just some of the examples. But God used that opportunity to birth some of these virtues in my life, that instead of getting mad, instead of getting like frustrated, I'm going to be self-controlling and I'm going to just play the game. Instead of being a poor sport, I'm just going to play the game, because I know that they're out of my league, but it's not going to stop me from playing. So I really think that God also wants to bring opportunity in your lives, to bring virtue in your lives. Some of us are praying for it, and he's already doing the work. You just got to look for that opportunity. Opportunities are presenting themselves every single day. I have a video here I want to show you from a movie. And honestly, it kind of just is self-explanatory, but it's so powerful. And to think that the prayers that we pray, and we're expecting a different outcome, but really, God's already moving. So if you can just play this video.
Oh, excuse me, can I get a refill, please?
Coming right up. Excuse me, are you all right?
Yeah. No, it's a long story.
Well, I like stories. I'm considered a bit of a storyteller myself.
My husband, have you heard of New York's Noah?
The guy who's building the ark.
That's him.
I love that story. Noah and the ark. You know, a lot of people miss the point of that story. They think it's about God's wrath and anger. They love it when God gets angry.
What is the story about then, the ark?
Well, I think it's a love story about believing in each other. You know, the animals showed up in pairs. They stood by each other. Side by side, just like Noah and his family. Everybody entered the ark side by side.
But my husband says God told him to do it. What do you do with that?
Sounds like an opportunity. Let me ask you something. If someone prays for patience, you think God gives them patience? Or does he give them the opportunity to be patient? If they prayed for courage, does God give them courage, or does he give them opportunities to be courageous? If someone prayed for the family to be closer, do you think God zaps them with warm, fuzzy feelings? Or does he give them opportunities to love each other? Well, I gotta run. A lot of people to serve. Enjoy.
Pretty powerful, yeah? And when you think about it, sometimes we're praying for all these things, and God's already providing the opportunities in our lives. Sometimes we're afraid of those opportunities. We don't want to go outside our comfort zone. But I really truly believe that God is moving and he wants us to have this virtuous life. You know, maybe some of you are sitting here today and you're longing for more virtue in your life. And maybe it is patience. You know, how many know that patience really is a virtue? You know how they say, patience is a virtue. Patience is a virtue. But it is. It really is. But it's true. You really can't learn patience. You really can't learn any of these things by just hearing it. I could preach a message on patience all day. But the only reason or way that you'll actually learn how to be patient is if I go so long that you look at your watch and be like, man, this guy's singing forever. And God has to use you to be patient, to wait for me to get done, which might be around this time. But it's just so precious to know and that God's with us, and these virtues that he has given us and provided to us, you know, it's something that must be practiced. This has to be practiced. The question is, how are we going to respond? How are we going to respond to what God is doing in our lives, the opportunities he presents to us? Because either we're going to respond with these fruits of the Spirit and in the virtues that he's given, or we're going to fall. And we're going to fall into our vices and our problems that we always love to fall back on because we're human. And naturally, that's just what we tend to do. And we're all in that boat sometimes. There is a battle between virtue and vice in our lives at times. That it is a choice on our part that we got to do our part. We got to put in the work. God has given us everything we need, but we got to work. And I pray as believers in God that we would never take this life for granted. You get one life and one life only. And I pray before you see the Father in heaven that you made it count. And it breaks my heart to see some people who miss the point. Because God has so much love for us. And he's lavished these things that has originated from him and from the source. And people choose to do it their own way. I've chosen to do it my own way. And I realize that that way will never work. That way will never sustain me. I will fall and fail every single time. The Lord wants to sustain you. He wants to put these virtues in your life. But we have to move. We have to grow in them. It's a responsibility that he has called us to. You know, the cure for sin and vice in our daily lives is to trust in God, is to let these things flow naturally. For God, Lord, fill me up, Lord. Fill me up so I overflow into other people's lives. So I overflow, Lord God. It's not on my own will, Lord, but it's on yours. If that could be a prayer in our hearts and lives, our lives should be so ever changed, authentically changed. Like Dr. Rick says in his book, there's authentic change. It's easy for us to say this and say that and put on a face, but true authentic change comes from God. I want to close in this concept of this battle between flesh and spirit, and we're going to continue this next week and focus in on the vices. And it might be a difficult message to swallow. It might be difficult, but know that these virtues are what keep us going. Pursue after these things. Because if we don't abide in the vine, if we don't cultivate these God-given gifts and these God-given virtues, we will always continue to battle the vices in our lives.
Thank you for checking us out here at Connect Point Church. We're so glad that you came across this message and hope it has blessed you. We'd love to connect with you. You can find us online at connectpointchurch.com and be sure to follow us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Have a great day and God bless.